more now on the unrest in Bahrain, where troops from neighboring Saudi Arabia and other Gulf countries have arrived to put down those anti-government protests that have lasted now more than a month. We're joined on the phone by Khaled Abdallah Janahi. He's the co-chair of the World Economic Forum's Global Agenda Council on the Middle East. He's also vice chairman of the Arab Business Council. Welcome to In Business. Khaled, what can you tell us about these reports, Saudi troops on the ground trying to put down these protests? How is this disrupting business?
I think Saudi troops are on the ground, yes, but are they there to bring down the protests? That's not been said by anybody. I think I've been here for 2 days now in Bahrain, coming from Geneva. I must admit, small little island, you know it, you've been here, but most of your audience don't know Bahrain, how small it is. And such a small place like Bahrain, the divide between the communities is unbelievable. The sectarian polarization in Bahrain is so big that people have basically got distrust between each other, and that is dangerous. I've been saying this for a long time, it's going to be extremely dangerous, and the reason is that we allowed this to happen over the past 10 years by creating so-called political sectarian societies, basically representing the people, and suddenly then you have the divide getting bigger and bigger between the two parties.
Well, and you have the Crown Prince saying that he would enter into some kind of dialogue with the opposition over the weekend, but that doesn't seem to be enough. Do you think, given the sectarian situation, that Bahrain's on the verge of civil war?
Well, that's what I was saying at the beginning. If Bahrain goes in a civil war, how can you have a civil war? We all live next door to each other. I mean, my neighbors are basically Shiites, Sunnis, and mixture of every aspect of the society. We cannot but walk from one place to the other because it's such a small place. We don't have sort of 50 or 60 or 70 miles between one town and the other. So it's going to be difficult to see how a civil war can exist in this place, although that's the way the people, the emotions are going forward.
Yeah.
And you're right, the Crown Prince has put forward, he's accepted six of the 12 preconditions that the opposition have put forward. And from my information, that the opposition said if four of them are agreed upon, then they will enter the dialogue. Now six has been agreed upon. And I think the more, there was a very good article today in one of the papers here that we as people, we have lost our country ourselves, that we've allowed this to happen. We've allowed this thing which is deep down, this hatred which exists, by keeping it, by not bringing it out, mm-hmm. is creating the problem that we have today.
So I mean, you've obviously got enough concern that you have Saudi Arabia and other Gulf countries sending in troops for some reason, as you say, that not coming officially. But with this pledge of aid of $10 billion to Bahrain from the Gulf Cooperation Council, the King of Bahrain handing out checks for $2,500 to citizens, I mean, what will happen that will cool off the situation? Because payouts don't seem to be working, is what you're saying.
I think it's very, very important that to recognize the following. This is something which is coming across the board everywhere now in the Arab world. Something which started because of lack of housing, because of lack of jobs, because of the increase in value of goods and food, started all this thing. And suddenly now everybody is looking at other aspects. They want to be citizens. They don't want to be subjects anymore. So everybody's following basically the tsunami which has come through from that side. Now, 10 billion, yes, I mean, and say 3 months ago, if 10 million was pledged by the GCC, would have been a beautiful thing for Bahrain. But I'll tell you one thing, it's going to be pledged, they're going to be pledged much more than 10 billion. My expectation is going to be $50 billion for the next 10 years to really do the housing and create jobs and everything else in Bahrain. So the economic factor in the medium to long term perspective, I only see positive, but really getting through the impasse that we have today, and I don't call it political impasse, now I call it actually social impasse, mm-hmm. of the people-to-people discussion. I think we all of us have to basically understand the emotions from the other side. Now suddenly you see things from Hezbollah, from Iran, everybody is basically talking about this little small little island of Bahrain. Now we as Bahrainis, we should and we must sit talk to each other and solve our problems without the interference of the others. Iran has its own national interests. I don't blame them to do what they want. The GCC, other countries, they have their own national interests.
Right.
But we as Bahrainis, we should be looking at our own interests and sitting for the dialogue. And fairness to the Crown Prince, he's really gone in a long way in terms of Bahrain, where we are today. You know Bahrain. Bahrain is ahead of its neighbors by a long shot when it comes to openness, when it comes to freedom of speech and everything else, we are ahead of everybody else.